Thank you. Thank you. Indeed it does. Hello and welcome to the very first live show of the Global Pedigree. I'm Dr. Cornelius, joined by the Chief Medical Guru, Albert Dudley. It's been a long time coming, but we are very excited
today. Well, 3 years in the making, it's been a lot of hard work, but it comes down to the 17th of the world's top players from 12 teams all over the world. It's a great meeting, some of the first season for the UBI.
Today is going to be a really great day. It's all going to be in six maps format. We've got four games coming at you. Let's take a look at that one. So first up, kicking off 12 p.m. Eastern time, it's the first of the Eurasian Conference teams. The Wolverines are the home day for this one. Who have you got planned?
It's going to be pretty exciting to see the likes of David Guetta, John Lennon, Hugo Gurdjieff. But maybe the star of the show here will be Dimitri Vandenberg's game, his first match for Moscow.
At 1:40 p.m. Eastern time, it's the second Eurasian game. It's not too different, there are a few changes
then. I think Gene Adams is coming to Scotland to getting the second goal. But it goes to Scotland, so Chris Norman included in this category of the world and making that switch. We'll also see a switch with one of the teams. So it'll be interesting to see the strategies as we go on.
At 3:30 p.m. Eastern time, we have the first of the Americas Conference. I have some set behind it, but home team this one.
I think a lot of people are buzzing over the eventual remix and figure of Hulk's matchup, so that's something that we'll have to do in the matches.
And then finally, the last game of today, 5:10 p.m. Eastern Time, is the second and final America's Conference game.
Yeah, former GPR1 number one, two former GPR1 number one, talking in this match, Brian Calloway and Anthony Zeno.
And we are now live from the GPR lounge, and I'm joined by our commentary team. We're sticking with Eurasian and America's kind of dual team going on here. From the UK, we are Sam Grafton, and from Canada, Kristen Pinson. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, sorry, I'm very excited. This is going to be an amazing opening match, and this season's almost excited to get to that.
Well, we've got 8 months of this over here, so what
I'm just excited to get the party in the air today. Obviously, there's been a lot of talk about the EPI, what's going on surrounding the draft. But this is a new format, this is a new launch for poker, and reputations are going to be made, and new stars are going to emerge. I'm excited to see how that plays out.
Yeah, I'm excited for the first match. When you look at it, we really have a sort of eclectic group of rising stars, people that have been unknown and involved in the one-on-one group. So there's a lot of, look at David Guetta, who's one of the biggest stars in poker right now, representing the pairs of leaders. But it's the first match that we're really looking forward to.
As we've seen, the rivalries already started. The two screens, and on the and Martin Matheson, and San Francisco Montreal matchup coming up later this week in Montreal. They've already started going at each other. This format will probably allow for a lot more rivalries to be fair.
Yeah, I mean, these are unbelievably competitive individuals. Most of these players can sit down and take them and leave them without rivalries breaking out. So, as we move to progress, particularly, of course, these guys aren't just playing to their own personal expectations, it's our own land. A lot of these people are representing their hometowns and representing their mates. So, you can expect rivalries for the match for sure.
Yeah, well, I mean, they've been poker a lot of the time, you know, you feel like you're playing for yourself only, but, a lot of the time these players compete in tournaments all over the world, you know, there's more pieces in front of them, they're damaging these assets, so it does need to create that team dynamic, and it's really interesting to see how they're going to fare and have to get points, not just for themselves, but for their friends, representing, the city or the country of Boston.
Well, we want your questions, your comments. Who do you think is going to win the GPL? Who do you think is going to finish up today with the most points? Who's going to go away with nothing today? Let us know on Twitter. Follow us at GPL. You can also use the hashtag GPL and also leave the comments on the Twitter. Now, we had draft day just around 6 weeks ago from Beverly Hills in LA. It was a really fun day. We enjoyed ourselves in your home.
I got to meet the two rising stars in gymnasium. I delivered as a gentleman of woman and for her with
children. Did you know the name?
That's right. I didn't recognize either of them before they were described. Russell and Joseph Stapleton, we did a good job of them too. So we had a great time there.
We did indeed. And if you missed it, you missed how all of the teams and all of the players came together. Take a good look now at our draft recap.
February 24, 2016, the entire world of poker tuned into the global poker league's Twitch stream to watch the inaugural GPL draft day up in real time at the SES Hotel in Beverly Hills, Los Angeles. We charged to leading the action NFL sports reporter Holly Sanders at the sideline to provide interviews, talent expert commentary tonight, including Joe Stapleton, Daniel O'Brien, Phil Hemmings, after GPI's Eric Dennis, the day was set to mark a breakthrough in poker. Each GPI team manager is given 3 minutes to choose a new team member to choose for the 4 rounds in the NFL expected draft, not, of course, without a few surprises on top sets along the way. The draft is intense, as managers from each of the 12 worldwide franchises had to choose from an impressive list of over 200 highly skilled poker players from the GPI Top 1000, combining over $5 million in collectible assets. The draft order has been predetermined by the lottery and the industry. Managers invested a great deal of thought into their predictable quantity and delight to be fair. Taking all of this extremely seriously,
also shocked these front jerseys. I think it's speaking worldwide poker. I mean, the fact that there's barely a week left in any of these teams. Berlin Bears are a case in point. Obviously, managed by Philip Gruson and Brian Maxwell, number one in the draft.
Yeah, this is a great team. You have a wide range of guys on the PG. It's obviously going to be a great representative from his German descent. And I've got to Jeff Rose, who was recently just in the poker media. Obviously, this has been done with.
And also, one of the wild cards, Randy Lou, now in Oakland online. He's got a very, very strong online history, represents poker stars as well. We expect big things from Randy, yes. Yeah, my hometown, unfortunately, I don't think there's any chance to be getting this thing, but we've got this card coming up. Yeah, right from the first round pick, through to the fourth round, and imagine getting just in Bonham, and of course, like a drug, absolutely incredible in the strength to get there. Sam Chippett, who lives herself, coming in as the wild card. I mean, they've got to be one of the favourites for the European conference, is that right?
Absolutely, you know, both of them were curved off in that first match, and then quite some bit of
I'm going to host our Dave Murray, I'm Tony Filetto, team manager, but a charismatic individual, and he picked Dimitri Ivanovich as his first round draft pick, and we're going to be seeing him in action today. Tell us a little bit about Dimitri.
Just an absolute superstar, just 20 years of age, just in the middle of the field, playing the World Series, and he's competing this summer. This is a kid that, you know, really kind of sees in the athlete he's learning, he's really good with baseball, and all those guys, and he's super fun, started playing super high rollers, and since he's already college, he's a kid of culture.
Yeah, well, I think one of the interesting things here, will we see a Russian style player edge? How will the Moscow Wolverines compete? You know, is there a different style coming out of what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things, you know, again, they're staying pretty global, but then obviously you're going to be close to the same blood, you know, you're going to have laughter, you're trying off to be a mainstream European program, and possibly getting deep top of the table to the PCA. Obviously, just a really talented group of players.
And the Paris Aviators? Obviously, they picked Elke, but from CBA, so manager, and Elke was the number one draft pick. I mean, he's got a lot of possibility, but he'll bring in a lot of fans, and there'll be a lot of people at the group that will say he's going to
manage. Yeah, obviously,
Elke needs
no introduction.
The artist formerly known as Coach. The Rome Emperors, managed by Max Pastore, they had the first round draft pick. Number one, they went for Mustafa Kett, an emerging superstar.
Yeah, I mean, this is a great team to talk about, but it's really all about starting to connect with someone like Lasagna. I mean, this kid is unbelievable. He's such a treat at the table. He's always making everyone laugh and taking all their chips and teaching everybody to do it. Just crushing super high rollers, crushing the events.
Yeah, exactly. So you've got the emergence of Mustafa, and then for the wild card, they went for a bit of more old school name, no offense, but Tom Brunson. That was an unusual pick. What did you think of that?
Yeah, it was really interesting because it was really surprising given the fact that a lot of the players were in the tiny league at the he was really interesting pick. I remember when he was drafted, he was and just celebrated on Twitter. It was like a big brother little brother thing. I'm sure that he might have increased the number of his
Moving on. All right, so
yeah, let's start talking about that. Was the EurAsia and Americas. Let's jump right into the Americas. All these sunsets.
He's had an amazing
2015. I mean, you look at what he's done in 2015. I mean, he's one of the things that WP champion has been as far as he's gone down, but maybe he's one of the one bunch of other higher rollers. Always seems to be getting every single big event. And then you run it off, and you don't have time to talk about you. He's actually going to focus on screen. He transformed into his own final table and then playing a bunch of high rollers himself.
And with the start, obviously, you know, he comes from a heads up segment. I mean, that's. You're talking about formats by being suited to transition over to GP. Someone with a heads up perspective, he can, you know, imagine those two. I think I'm better for
the show. So, someone trying to get this person in, obviously, being after one of the most famous poker players ever, with Chris Hoffman. Let's talk about culture and
business. Well, I'm speaking over first one into that. But also, they've got my boy, Fred Cody, and not to be underestimated, the British contingent. I know he has great former person, so I guess that's really true. I mean, you're not worried about what you're talking about. He obviously has he's one of the people playing in the Olympics, he's one of the series of both Brunson, playing in 25K heads up event. So he has a strong heads up event as well. And that's probably one of the reasons Chris Hoffman picks his own.
And on a big release, I think some of us like that Jonathan Kuhlman, but he's doing wonderful options. So Chris is off,
and he's not a pitcher of football, does that mean? I'm quite a much more masculine. Mark Algeri this year is the team manager. producer. For me, looking at the Americas teams, this is probably the strongest one of the four of them, if we're talking about the initial impression. Interesting things is some people have gone for bringing together different elements of the dog community. Here, bringing them for guys who knows, guys who don't like the works there as a team. I think that's got a bit of advantage here. Going into the season, you're a unit, you're competing for each other, and you share each other. So, San Francisco Rush, for us, he picked four guys on this example. What do you think of this one?
Yeah,
it's
almost brilliant for us, John.
Works really hard in the game, she's putting together more and more results on the tournament circuit. So she'll definitely be able to obviously answer quite interesting. One of the doctors that owns the week, those regular one. So now we're matching politics. Let's talk about opportunity. Brazil may be home of sports on poker. It's such a growing game there. Andrew Opari is in the graphic now, he's not actually picked himself. What do you think of this time team? Obviously, they did better in the lights, something that just went number one to their team.
You know what, that was a shock for a lot of people, and then to a lot of reports in the media, it was surprising that they're like, that's what they're in the lights, as far as like, poker talent is concerned, just that team presence, I mean, he's a guy, you draft him in the first round, and he's just skipping, he's unbelievable,
exactly a great GPS-2 game. You've got a Brazilian foundation, you've got two foreign superstars on the Intel team. If you can get that working together as a team, sharing strategy, that Brazilian creative style of play, it's going to be really exciting. Let's see how we are. A lot of people that are rooting for Brazilian matchups.
So let's pass it back to Laura, the game
consists of 12 world teams, 6 in the EurAsia conference, and 6 in the American conference. Each team has a total of 6 players, and the number of that team that you should ever be allowed to play at any time. Divided each player on their team plays a minimum of 6 matches across the season. The GPL starts the regular season with 8 weeks of 2-1 career action, which consists of 6 weeks and 7 matches. Every team secured 26 seats from each conference will face off in 2 6 weeks of the games. One team in each conference will play the home team, while the other 5 will away. The team managers have the ability to pick their players from 6 seats or not at the
Not only the team taking advantage of student digital, but being better at talking also see if the player who's on their side is quite bold, how you manage that as well.
Well, it's time to take a look at day 6 maps for this very first game of the Global Poker League. Let's take a look at those players. Sam, through them back to you.
Goes into this, gets a bunch of heroes, a bunch of superstars, even can come out of it. And then one of the wild cards, Daniel Pates, gentleman, huge successful one, one of the superstars of the game, one of the most exciting players that we saw at the wild card.
This is a guy that usually finds his way online at the biggest, highest stakes tables. I mean, if you look at some of the online reports every week, he's always splashing around hundreds of thousands of dollars in swings. And this is a guy that, despite the fact that he's not necessarily here to play for a lot of money, he's someone that has, you know, obviously a huge ego, takes a great pride in what he does. So he's someone that's just going to come out swinging, come out firing. And this format, like we talked about, it really does favor him.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the question for me is, can Philip Gruesome keep him focused when he's playing that high stakes? Can he come and bring his A game to this format? I mean, that remains to be seen, but everyone's excited that Daniel Cates is part of the Global Poker League. That's
now,
for sure.
I'm really excited to move on to David E. Katai, to jump the gun a little here, but he is the most exciting player, in my opinion, from this group. An excellent selection by the Paris Aviators.
Yeah, his live records speak for themselves. Obviously, he's a Triple Crown winner. He's won, I think, 2 WPT titles.
10 wins. Unbelievable.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the question with Davide is he comes from that live background,
right?
I think. So there's no doubt that in the summer series, he's going to be a formidable opponent. No one's going to want to face him heads up, particularly after, you know, where his famous cool down against Andrew Chen. But can he do it online? And then another first-round draft pick, this time for the Moscow Wolverines.
I mean, you can't say enough about this kid. We already, touched on it in the intro. I mean, this is a kid from Poland, just 20 years of age, just made a huge splash, already earnings up to almost $5 million. His first result was in July of 2013. The ripe age of 18, and here he is, as a first-round selection.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about Dimitri is he's put really a lifetime's worth of results into just 12 months, and that's incredible. He's gone as a first-round draft pick, even though he's only a couple of years into his career. So, yeah, that's very, very impressive. And then for the Hong Kong Stars, we've got Wei Yi Zhang, who I'm sure his stats will come up in a moment for us. Also goes by the, helpfully goes by the nickname of Wayne as well. I was seeing a bit more footage of Dimitri. Yeah, so Wei
can't get enough to do. They needed the GPL here. Let's be honest.
So Wei Yi Zhang for the Hong Kong Stars. What do we know about him, Griffin?
Well, he's obviously someone who's cut his teeth on the in the APPT. Someone who was selected by the Hong Kong Stars and Selena Lin. This is a guy whose GPI ranked 367, earnings of only 450,000, but a lot of results, a couple of wins. You know, his name online is ZWYYY, second place in the Hot 33. Very, very catchy. But yeah, he's won two events in 3 days at the Macau Poker Cup in September of 2015. So he's someone that's, you know, obviously going to come out there.
Again, this is one of the things about the GPI. Some of these players come with big reputations. Someone like Wei Yi Zhang, we know a little bit less about, but he can come out and make a name for himself today.
So yeah, this is obviously there's going to be a few changes in the second match. Interesting decisions by the managers. The London Royals deciding to sub in Igor Kurganov and bring in Chris Moorman. I think that's pretty much the best sub you can ask for in 13 million in cashes. So Selena Lin is going to be subbing in Raiden Khan. But in the meantime, let's throw it back to Laura, who has a special guest for us here today.
We do indeed. Joining us now in the GPL lounge, we have the manager of the Paris Aviators, Fabrice Soulier.
Hello,
thanks
guys.
For joining us.
Thank
First
you.
Of all, let's talk about your whole GPL experience this far. How has it been for you?
It's been great. It's been a great team experience, and we had a lot of chat, and we've been discussing, and it's been a group set up by you guys, actually, where all the manager could talk, the players could talk, and it was very nice to let us think about the process also, and you know, involve us in the process, and I really appreciated that.
Fabrice, I want to go back to the draft. I've been talking to a lot of managers, you as well, but the Las Vegas picking Jonathan Duhamel, I think it had an impact on, or at least made people like you, it just proved that you made a smart decision in going with someone like Elke first. I think a general consensus was that Davidi Kitai was probably the best player in for you at that moment, but with Selena Lin having two picks and Elke's exposure to the Asian market, that was a strategic move. Again, people thought that managers might have been nice to each other. Maybe Kurganov could have gone third to fourth round to live. She knew to draft him early, and you knew to do the same thing with Elke.
Yes, absolutely. I was scared that Selena might take Elke first, so he's half Korean. But, you know, he loves Korea. He's been playing, like, video games there. He was a superstar in Korea, so I knew that the Hong Kong team could be interested in Elke. So that, then I wanted to make sure to get Elke. And I knew they wouldn't like, I mean, they like Davide, but they don't know him enough, you know, and they had no connection with him. So it was not risky for me to let Davide go in second. I knew I would get Davide second.
Just quickly, Mike Lea has become the favorite pick, I think, by many people. That came out of left field. As you know, I did a lot of research. In no way, shape, or form did I think that pick was going to happen. I did think that Mike would be picked. I just did not think it would be a Paris Aviators pick. But you've told me that Mike actually is so committed to this process, and that's probably one of the reasons why you picked him.
Yeah, I love Mike. I love his dedication to the game. I've always played with him. He's always been such a nice guy at the table, always so sweet, you know, talking strategy, very passionate. And I have absolutely no regret. I mean, he's one of the most motivating. Every time we have a call group together, he's talking a lot of strategy, taking a lot of, you know, lines. And yeah, he's bringing a lot to the team. I love Mike.
So Davide is playing the Six Max, which is coming up very soon, less than 5 minutes or so now. I know. How nervous are you? And what sort of plans and preparations have been put into practice before this match for him?
We were at the beach this afternoon because he's in Malta at the moment.
The beach?
So David is living in Malta, and so am I with my family now. So it's great. I mean, we were at the beach, we were discussing, and it was wonderful. So I hope he's going to do well. I mean, I'm very confident with David. I mean, I think Sam was pointing that he was maybe not the best, the most experienced player online, but actually he's playing a lot of six maxes online. So I think he's going to be a very tough opponent to beat.
Did he get any tan at the beach?
I hope it did. I think it did. Yeah.
Right, it is time now to look at our very first matches of the Global Poker League.
Good luck.
We'll be right back.
I'm a big fan of the intro music. I'm not gonna lie. Okay, so we're almost about to get started here with the first match. This is a pretty exciting time.
Yeah, of course. These guys are gonna go out there and make history. I mean, this is the beginning of a whole new league, a whole new way of looking at poker. And you're there day one, and you could be the first winner of the first match of the GPL. I mean, making history.
I mean, I think it's gonna be epic. I mean, it's too bad Epic Poker League was taken. Yeah, we looked into it. No, so we had to go global.
Okay, well, that's good. It's good that that's played out. Well, I actually thought this was Epic Poker League.
No, so, yeah, you're in the wrong place.
Check my notes. Okay, so, Igor Kurganov, uh-huh. Dmitry Ivanovich, you know, we're going hard right from the word go here in the Global Poker League.
Yeah, I mean, a star-studded lineup, obviously, to get things going.
And we heard from Fabrice, what would you expect of Davide Kataj? Is he at home sweating? Is he running numbers and push balls? He's at the beach. He's getting a bit of a
tan. He's at the beach. He's smoking a cigarette. He's very, very lax. I mean, this is a guy that's very deliberate in all his actions. It's too bad that we won't be able to see that the way that he is live, just slowly getting things done and staring people down. But as Fabrice pointed out, you know, this is a guy that obviously plays a lot of six max and he's been preparing for this format. So I think he'll be ready. I think we're just trying to find reasons that he's not going to be an absolute. This is a beast here, but I think that he's really the guy to watch.
Yeah, of course. I mean, no one's mugging off Davide Kataj.
No,
don't get me wrong. I was just questioning, you know. So anyway, we're ready to go. I think things are ready to kick off and we're going to the tournament, and the guys are going to get it underway. And here we go, the first hand of the
first
Global Poker League.
And as obviously you see, Walter starting things off with queens in the big blind. I would expect an open here from Igor, to open things off.
Yeah, I mean, we're worried about young Walter, but if he gets hands like this, pretty frequently, he'll do all right, I'm sure.
I imagine he'll just be flatting in this situation. Obviously, there's an argument to be three-betting, but in the first hand, it's going to really disguise his hand, and Igor's just going to fold worse so often if he makes it around 2,000 here. But he might be going sort of for a play-to-win kind of strategy as well, and it looks like that is actually the
great prediction there. Starting things off as you mean to go on. Griffin Banger there, ladies and gentlemen. You can see why he's semi-retired. He spends a lot of the time at the beach. And do you expect Igor to call here?
Surprising to see him call in this situation, but obviously Igor feels very, very comfortable and confident playing deep stacked. Interesting to see him call in this situation, but again, maybe he just feels like the kid's trying to make an early impression in the first hand.
Well, let me ask you about that. Obviously, these guys are super smart strategists of the game, but do you think that anyone, it will have an effect, the fact that there's so much focus on this, as we say, making history, the first ever game on the GPL? Do you think people are going to almost put on a little bit of a show for the cameras?
It's hard to say. I mean, again, like I said about when it comes to Walter, I do kind of expect him to splash around. I think that might have been in Igor's head in that hand, and he didn't want to just like open things up with a 3x the big blind and then just fold to a 3-bet. So first hand is going to go to Walter. It'd be really interesting to see if he decides to 3-bet right away. It would really make an impression, but just flatting here.
Yeah, so this is our first chance to see Wei Zhang in or Wayne, I think that's not just something I made up. He does go by the name of Wayne. So Wayne opening up the button.
Yeah, 7-10 suited. I mean, pretty standard all the way around here. Davide deciding to come along with the wheel ace.
I mean, let's be honest. Mm-hmm. We're not going to see Davide Kataj fold his big blind.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we can't make many predictions about the Global Poker League, but Davide Kataj surrendering his big blind without a fight, you know, I can tell you poker fans, that's not going to happen too often.
Yeah, I've seen him defend much wider than that in the big blind. We do see a continuation bet here by Wayne. I would expect a call by Walter here. Interesting to see that Wayne is just trying to rep this particular texture, given he doesn't have any back doors. It's a good texture.
Why he doesn't have any back doors, you mean he has absolutely nothing.
Exactly.
He has 10 high. He's on a wing and a prayer, the lad. And this is actually a card which improves both hands.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, Wayne might decide to take a freebie here, even though he has turned basically the only equity that he was going to be able to turn, because Walter does have a lot of kings in his range. All of Walter's pocket pairs that are going to float the flop are obviously probably not going to fold the turn. But we do see Wayne decide to fire again,
come on.
I would imagine that
Walter.
Come on,
Wayne Zhang. I'm Wayne.
I love to see the dark horses of this matchup just come out firing here.
And you expect, obviously, Volta to call now he's turned an open-ended
interesting river here. I think Wayne a lot of the time is going to expect Valter to have sort of king, queen, king, jack, maybe king, ten suited type of hands, not folding. So it's interesting to see if Wayne decides to fire three here and hope Valter has a hand pretty much exactly like he has.
Yeah, I mean, of course, we know that a third barrel here is going to work, but, you know, he's not necessarily going to have a hand like pocket fives. Could have a much stronger holding than that. That's right, yeah, Griffin?
Yeah, absolutely. And the jack really can improve Valter a lot when he's flattening the small there with a lot of king jacks. So I think it was a good check back by Wayne, even though Valter in that situation probably would have folded.
Mate,
and I wasn't crazy about the two barrel.
I mean, our boy, Valter, here we go.
And he's going to go three in a row here. He's definitely
going to open the button. We've wrapped him as the underdog, and he's going to win the first three pots. I mean, maybe. It depends if Eagle Valter gives that win.
I mean, three hands in, and the only person to have won a hand in the Global Poker League is Valter. Actually, a really loose defend here by Igor Kurganov, and actually outflopping him here with the 9-5 off.
Well, this is one of the exciting things, I know, for both of us, and I'd imagine the guys back home. I mean, one of the exciting things is just to see some of these great players play and see how they see their hole cards and what hands they're choosing to defend the big blind with, what hands they're choosing to open with. I mean, we both probably would have folded that Queen 10, but you know, the thing that we're going to be learning is how these great strategists, these great poker minds, how they create their ranges, i.e. the hands they play, and what hands they choose to play pre-flop and how they play in post-flop.
Yeah, Valter getting lucky there, obviously turning the queen, but there's a lot of cards that Valter would have won on the turn there. You know, any king, eight, jack, we would expect him betting again. So tough to hold on there for Igor with that particular runner anyway.
Maybe Volta's just going to win every hand. Just dominate the table.
Oh, I would love to see him open this 9-4 off, but I think it's going to go right into the muck. Yeah, you know what? You were talking sort of about what we can learn by just watching. And that's sort of the thing, is that there's so many different ways and so many different viewers that can appreciate what we're seeing. I mean, guys like us who, you know, obviously have a lot of experience playing online and live and playing, you know, playing against these guys, we're still going to be able to learn from them. People just new to the game, they're going to see the best of the best.
Winner of Shark Cage season one.
Even I have something to learn. Even me.
Wow. Okay.
So interesting that Igor limp folding the small there with 7-8 and then Urbanovic just raising it up. Very deliberate actions by Igor early on. He pretty much knows exactly what he's going to do. I think it's, you know, he probably feels like his strengths are going to be in these earlier levels. He's trying to keep the pace up, and obviously we appreciate it here in the booth.
Yeah, and this is our first chance to see Daniel Cates, jungle man, in action. Do you think him and Igor have played a lot together?
I wouldn't necessarily think so. I don't know if Igor necessarily spends a lot of time playing the high-stakes cash games. Having said that, I'm sure they've played a fair bit of it against each other and maybe a few super high rollers and some high rollers on the EPT. A check back here by Igor and betting the turn. We're going to expect to see a call there from Cates fairly often, but I guess he just reads that as stronger as it is, and he's going to rescind that first pot for Igor.
Yeah, and here it's going to be a chance to see Davide Kutai coming in for an open with ace king suited. I mean, you spoke in the introductions there about what a fan you are of Davide Kutai. I know I feel the same as well. He's sort of a player that is a sort of iconic figure on the tour. When it comes to, like, field player, that's a player, you know, who goes by their instincts, a live player, who can sort of has those old-school poker qualities of just being able to say, kind of, does he has it? That's what Davide Kutai represents. That's right, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he's someone that, you know, especially in a tournament format where, you know, deeper in the tournament, when you get on day threes and days fours and stuff like that, the ante's are really kicking up. He's going to be involved, you know, anywhere between sort of 30 and 45% of the hands, at least in my experience, yeah, watching him on the EPT. So he's someone that, you know, he's going to play a lot of different hands. He's going to do some sort of abstract things, and that's what really makes him someone to watch out for.
For sure. And so we've got Dan Cates open the button. And would you perhaps have seen, expected to see Valter through that hand like ace-jack off?
I don't think so. I mean, the Queens was obviously a spot where it can be recommended to just flat. But in this situation,
can
I way prefer.
Now, by the way? Do you think you can body bet the ace-jack off?
I think it's obviously very thin, but Cates is. I think he's going to fold a lot of hands that he might even bluff on the river if he's just an opening with something like king nine or queen high rather.
Nice to see Valter doing well. as I said, we shouldn't be patronising about him. Max Pescatore, you know, he's not going to put someone in his team and certainly not put someone into action in the first day who he doesn't have a lot of confidence. And now we're going to have a Dan Cates, Davide Guitar matchup. Superstars everywhere.
Yeah.
We look at this table.
I'm loving the pace. I mean, they're playing quick. You know, all of these guys really know what they're going to be doing. Obviously, you know, the shot clock is something that's going to be affecting, you know, they don't want to waste time. And I like that. I mean, a lot of the complaints in recent memory, when you look at sort of the EPT and, you know, a lot of these high rollers is just how long some people take. And I'll be interested to see, you know, guys like Byron Caverman, who have a reputation for taking a heck of a lot of time, see how he adjusts and if he's going to be playing as quick or as deliberate as these guys.
Yeah, and Danny Cates paying off a riverbet there with the pocket sevens. Was that right? Did he call there on the river?
I believe it was checked through to the river there. I mean, obviously we're going to have to get used to the software, but it appeared as though it was checked the river, yeah.
I should make sure I'm aware of that. So Volta, imagine looking at the video and Igor in the blog. It's not an appetizing prospect.
But just opening it up with the 7-8 off. I mean, this is a kid that's ready to splash around with the best of them. We could see some preflop leveling here as David Akatai is going to take advantage of that button open, and this should go through a fair bit.
Yeah. Obviously, the blind structure is pretty rapid. You can see we've gone up from to 150 300. How long are the blind levels again, Griff?
I believe that's have a right now. You're trying to throw me on the spot here.
On, I thought you were. You're
the blind guy. Well,
okay. Shouldn't put my co-presenter on the spot.
Well,
like
it's
that.
Right. I mean, it's right there on the screen. I'm just. Well, can we talk about the Urbanovic aces? It's right there. Blind 6 minutes.
All right. Okay.
Both 6 minutes left. 8 minutes to start.
Oh, look at this. We've got.
This is trouble.
Yeah, we've got an exciting hand here. Bolt's coming in for a raise, which is pretty standard. And Dimitri.
This might be the elimination for Daniel Cates, unfortunately. It's obviously a super cooler. Everything just seems to be going Urbanovic's way in the last year. In this spot, you know,
maybe
once,
this is how he's won so much money.
Maybe this is it. I mean, once Cates comes in here for the re-raise to about 5,000, I think that he's probably just going to be calling off the extra 50 big blinds and hoping that he's in a race.
Yeah. So Volta is going to pass. And so comes back to Dimitri. Do you think he's ever going to consider flatting? Given that his, putting in the fifth bet pre-flop, I mean, that's a very, very, can only be done with a very, very strong holding.
I think that he's going to be shoving a lot here, and I don't really expect him to be flatting fairly often. What do you think? I think he'd want to be balanced to make sure that the Cates calls off with, you know, the Queens and the Jacks
sure.
or what have you.
For sure.
Or Ace-King in this
and
case.
There we go, he's jammed.
Yeah.
Oh, dear Daniel Cates.
That's a great flop for Daniel, though.
And we have our first elimination out for 0 points, a donut, Dan Cates.
Yeah, I mean, it's just one of those things. We talked about how he was going to be one of the most dangerous players in this Six Max and Heads Up format, but, you know, the way that poker is, she giveth and she taketh away. And in that situation, not at all surprising to see the chips go in, and unfortunately for him, he's our first elimination.
Yeah, that's two. I mean, we're going to have some new viewers, some people that aren't as familiar with poker. I mean, Ace-King, Aces... That situation, there's no avoiding the chips going
in. And the Six Max format especially, you know, a lot of people are used to seeing poker on television where it's, you know, nine-handed and stuff like that, where maybe, you know, for instance, at the recent World Series of Poker when Daniel Negreanu was able to get away from Ace-King and for that amount of chips, obviously it's a bit different, you know, finals tables of the main event. But, you know, when there's nine players at a table, it becomes a lot easier to avoid those kind of coolers. Yeah. Six max format, there's no way that he's letting that go. And Urbanovic was recognized that when he put in the fourth bet there, that he had a hand he was not folding.
Yeah, I agree completely. And I think that's real unfortunate for Daniel. The great thing about the GPL is he'll be back. We'll get to see him in action again. He can go away, lick his wounds.
Let's pick up the action here in this hand, though. This is interesting. It was a defend by Volta with the pocket twos. Queens for David Ikatai. I don't mind the peel on the flop here. Obviously, we know that David E has pocket queens, so he's almost, well, now he is fully dead, especially with Wayne folding a deuce in the small blind before the turn even came out. But I would expect Volta to probably give it up on this turn. An interesting overbet here by Ikatai. Obviously, he's expecting sometimes when Volta has ace high, he's probably going to fold almost any bet on the turn here.
Yeah.
But when he has a 10, it's going to be very hard for him to fold, and Ikatai just wants the whole lot.
Yeah, and Volta folds, and that's obviously, we know, a good decision, and probably a good decision against Davide's range, the range of possible hands he can have, for sure. So he folds the button, and it's going to be Davide. Did he limp the small? No, he defended against...
No, this was a raise under the gun from Igor to 800. Interesting check back here. Katai, obviously, hugely in the lead here with the ace nine. Great flop for him, especially with the two spades on the flop. We're going to just see a bet and a call here because of the turned equity for Igor. Any jack, king, or queen.
And he can probably go for value again, particularly when he's got the ace of spades in his hand. It's going to remove some of...
I think it's gonna remove a lot of the spade combos because Igor would probably continuation bet them. I don't necessarily think Katai will go for value here. I think that he might end up just check calling, just because a lot of the time Igor is going to have a hand the way he has. Sometimes I guess you could have something like pocket eights, but I feel like Igor would maybe bet that.
It's great to see how quickly, Igor released immediately, and people are acting very speedily at this table. And again, we've got some strong holdings out there, particularly considering we're just five-handed now. Three real premium hands out there.
Yeah, one thing we weren't able to remark about that last hand was the bet sizing on the river by Davide Katai. I think that's something that people are going to see, a lot of really interesting, intricate bet sizes from David. I mean, you bet, almost one-fourth of the pot there.
And it's going to be on him now, and he's got a decision about how to play this hand.
Yeah, this is a really tough spot for Davide. I mean, if he puts in the fourth bet here, I think we'll see folds from both opponents. But it's obviously a really tough spot for Volter. And obviously, if he puts the shove through, it's going to actually, obviously Davide isn't going to be calling with ace-queen here.
I mean, with these kind of pot odds, he can just flat in position, having a button.
Right.
That seems to me to make sense about a way to proceed with this particular holding. Obviously, it's an interesting situation when two players have the same hand, see how it plays out, but he does take the more cautious route and folds, as you suggested.
Yeah, and I like the sizing there by Davide. It's not a hand that you really want to be playing out of position in such an inflated pot like that.
But do you think
making it almost 3x there, I think it just really defines that he has a strong hand and not letting Volter peel there with something like, a jack 9 suited or 9-10 suited or what have you.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. And again, this is something that to me seems a little bit unorthodox, but very... fits in with Davide's style of playing a lot of hands flat in the 8-7 series on the button.
Yeah, this is about hand reading. I mean, Davide feels really comfortable playing against, obviously someone that he probably perceives as not as good as him in this format. Obviously, Wayne Zhang has a lot of success and is a great player and might sniff this out here with the ace-jack off, but a lot of pressure in a spot like this where it's like, does he really want to be four-betting all-in, with ace-jack off? And all eyes are on him in a situation like that. So a great spot by Igor, recognizing how wide Davide's going to be flatting the button there. And then with the ace blocker, a lot of the time Wayne's not going to have a hand that he can really go with.
Yeah, of course. And another thing to say is these guys are probably seeing it like we're seeing it on a delay. He's going to notice that Davide's once he's flatted once with 8-7 off, it's going to be interesting to see whether he can do it again now that his opponents know that's the kind of strategy he's employing.
Pretty standard hand here. Wayne trying to get involved with the loose-ish defend with 8-5 off. But again, this is something that we've seen in the last few years in poker, a lot of wider defends, being priced and that sort of thing. We've seen it with the 9-5 off from Igor earlier, the 8-5 off there. And the blinds are now up to 2-4, and you're really starting to see how quickly these matches can end up going.
Yeah, for sure.
But on 25K starting stack, still a lot of play involved here, so I'm really loving the pace in this first match, and this is really kind of what you're going to come to expect from the Global Poker League.
Yeah, fast-paced action for sure. And Davide Katai with ace-queen is probably just going to peel this through bet. I mean, that's very typical of Davide's style. He likes to see flops, yeah.
Yeah, he's someone that prides himself in his hand reading ability, and obviously ace queen suited five handed is going to play extremely well to a three bet. Interesting to see if he were to peel here on this texture.
He's definitely going to pull for sure.
Yeah, especially to that sizing. Oh well then.
Well, if either of these players fold, they're not going to be quite as strong poker players as we initially perceived.
Yeah, I mean they both have the June killed nuts.
So can we just recap that? I don't know who, but my mum's tuned in. Yeah.
I'm
pretty sure my mum's tuned in to see a boy. This is quad sevens.
So we've got to do the mama Grafton
exactly.
Breakdown.
These guys have the same hand now at this point. Yes. Just Sandra Grafton back home.
Yep, it's the best five cards win.
Yep.
And in this situation, the kickers are irrelevant and obviously a fortunate turn card for David E. We're going to probably just see a call here from Dimitri and then a bet and a shove, and they're both going to sort of like, you know, sigh and yawn it off.
Yeah, that's he's clicked it back. Oh, Dimitri. I don't know whether, I think it's pretty obvious what both players have. Certainly what Dimitri has at this point, and David E. can probably save his time back a little and just rip it in. So one of the things we should just reiterate, it was mentioned at the top of the broadcast, but Dan Cates left with 0 points. Mm-hmm. Everyone else, this is going to go to showdown and they're going to chop it up. Everyone else is now, in a way, in the money. They made points. Fifth place is going to get 1 point. Fourth place, second. Third place, 3 points. Second place, 5 points. And first place is going to get 7 points. You know, it's actually pretty top-heavy structure, yeah? I mean, 17 points are all distributed in those top two. I mean, there's a lot of incentive to go for the win in this format.
Yeah, and that's another, you know, sort of testament to how, you know, the situation that Daniel Cates found himself in. I mean, it was just a cold-blooded cooler either way, but it's really going to be hard to make massive folds when there's, you know, so much. I mean, even if Urbanovic turns over kings there, you know, his ace-king's going to still win 30% of the time, and he's already put a quarter of his stack in. So a lot of the time we're going to see some guys going for it. But, yeah, obviously the rest of the players were thrilled to see that early cooler and get their franchise on the board in this, you know, historic first match.
And Dimitri just firing once and then surrendering the pot to Davide there. So in terms of chip stacks now, obviously Dimitri, as we said, the caller, he's in a very, very strong position. But also, Davide Kitai, without having won a big all-in like Dimitri, he's up to 37K and looking strong. As Fabrice said, I mean, I called into question Davide's background, but he is sponsored by Winamax. It is quite possible. And one of the things we don't know about poker is, you know, cash game results are obviously not always tracked. Davide seems to be very, very comfortable in this format.
Absolutely. Interesting hand here with Urbanovic opening. He's decided to check the 10-10-9 two-spade flop. It's going to create a difficult decision for Volter here on the turn. Big river for Volter there, rivering the straight. Urbanovic tried to play that king-10 sneaky, and unfortunately, even with the huge percentage edge there, it's not going to work out for him.
And he is betting this river for value.
Not crazy about this river bet. I mean, you know, I feel like Volter's going to have a lot of jacks in his range anyway, so maybe Dimitri just wanted to set the price, but yeah. I certainly don't think he was getting a six to fold.
I mean, King Jack was a double better as well, so yeah. It's definitely hard to get pulled by Volter.
Now, when we're talking about sort of ranges for people flatting and that sort of thing, you know, a lot of the time, Volter's going to have a lot of Broadway combos there, your queen jacks, your king jacks, you know, your king queens, pocket sixes. So it is a weird sort of block bet by Dimitri. I feel like if I was in that situation, I would begrudgingly check fold. But again, he's going to be so much better.
But Griffin, you're a shark cage winner.
No, but
what experience has he got in the shark cage?
I just my point is that there's just so much to learn from these guys and how good they are. It's interesting to see a spot that you know we have played differently. And it's so fascinating to see their whole cards and to think like, why did he decide to make that bet? Because Dimitri is just literally one of the best players on the planet right now.
Yeah, crushing the game, for sure. I think Davide might open here on the cutoff with the king six suited. Seems like a reasonable holding.
Dimitri with the no equity check raise actually on that previous hand. Defended with the 10-8 of spades and check raised the queen, I believe, 7-3-2 club board. So he's someone that's just going to put a lot of pressure on the less experienced player. And we learned that right there.
And Wei Zhang is, I mean, this seems like a pretty slam dunk call.
Obviously, this is an example of a texture that, even though Wei Zhang has the best hand, it's going to be hard for him to call this flop. Yeah.
Texture. What do you mean by texture?
So board texture, what we're talking about is just what comes out on the flop and how that's going to affect the fold. So in the case of the 10-10-9 board texture, that's going to hit Volker's range a lot, given that he's flatting on the button. You know, he's going to have a lot of 10x suited hands. He's going to have a lot of queen jack suited hands, maybe some pocket pairs.
Yeah.
So that's what we're talking about. We're talking about board texture.
That's true. I know that Sandra Grafton is appreciating that interpretation. I'm loving it. So, gets the river, and really the tide doesn't make you flush, but hits king on the river. And I imagine this is going to be strong enough.
It's all coming up, Dibby.
I mean, the man's won everything else in the game. He might as well go and add, and like I said, he needs to make more history. Go and win the first round of the GPL.
And this is what I'm talking about with the different kind of betting frequencies that we see from a guy like David. He's someone that's so fascinating to watch because you can really start to think about poker in a more abstract way and how you can bet, you know, one quarter, one third of the pot here, over bet a turn here. So he's just someone that's so fun to watch and just, you know, just that beautifully eccentric kind of way that he plays the game. It's thrilling. It's great.
So this is really interesting. Dimitri's nimmed the button with pocket jacks, which is pretty, I would say, unorthodox.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's sort of a perceived range of hands that you have when you limp the button a lot of the time. People are limping buttons, especially, I guess, a more shorter stack, like, you know, hands like Jack 8 suited, or you know, King 10 suited, King 9 suited, or maybe even 9 10 off. So I think that it's something that he's just deciding to do to kind of balance his range there, where he actually can have a monster. And he also just wants to see a flop with a hand that's going to be dominating the one pair of hands. I mean, Volta there had the 9 5 off, and if he'd come to 5 or 9 on the board, he gets a bet. Whereas normally, if he'd open the button, Volta's out of the pot. So it's easy to, when we see the pull cards, to understand and validate these sort of obscure tendencies of these players. But again, would you have limped the jacks? Would I have limped the jacks? Would even pros back home have limped the jacks? Probably not. But when we see it happen, we're just like, oh, that actually makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, for sure. So, Dimitri, three back here with the...
No, he just defended. The blinds are up to 3-6. Dimitri opened to 1,500.
Oh, he did through that.
Yeah, he did through that. I thought some of us were following the action. It's not all about the sound of our own voices.
That was greasing the brain of his tires.
But Dimitri defended, and Dimitri just checked both streets and checked both.
And you know, the fact that he decided to check fold that particular texture is kind of a testament to Davey just knowing the kind of hands that Ivanovic, I think, is going to be calling three bets with.
Yeah.
And a 9-9-8 board, I think that hits Ivanovic, you know, a fair amount of the time that Davey's like, you know what, I thought I could just get this through pre-flop with the blockers. For the layman out there that you're not familiar with the term blockers, it means, you know, you have like a king and a jack in your hand, so it makes it less likely for your opponent to have that kind of hand. Probably expected once he three bet for Ivanovic to be folding, you know, his opening, what, probably 80% of the time there in the cutoff? Maybe a little less than that.
Yeah, obviously by having two, 60-70%.
Two blockers, you block.
Especially with the momentum that he had up there.
So, you can see, well, it's
really, really big hand here.
Yeah.
Obviously, a free bet from Igor pre-flop. He got the flop he wanted, and oh, wow, we're going to see a snap call here. Big pot here for Igor. Just has to dodge an ace or a six for a chop. Really, really well played by Igor. We got
Dimitri had a turn of first.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, and a big double up for Igor Kovalev. Checked Dimitri by checking the turn. Obviously, Dimitri had turned a lot of equity.
Yeah.
Turning that flush draw and the Dutch up for a chop.
And that's why he floated the flop, too, is that he thought there was a lot of turn cards that he was going to be able to shove. And
but that's a big swing, because we could have lost Igor, who, for a lot of people, is the favorite going into this match. And, you know, it's Dimitri, who's the target stack, and now it's Igor, who is the chip leader.
Wei Zhang can't catch a break here. If he does decide to shove and make a stand here against Volta, I think that it's probably going to go through. But it'd be a tough shove to make, especially when he has the opportunity now to potentially move up if Urbanovic loses. You know, we're going to have a shift out there, too.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things. In such a tough lineup, even a player of the caliber of Wei Zhang, who was a first-round draft pick, I believe, you know, you can't pick on Davide Guitar, you can't pick on Igor Kovalev, so they're going after Wei Zhang a little bit harder than perhaps if they're going after other guys. And relentless from Dimitri, and
I would imagine these chips are going to be getting in if
if it's Urbanovic's intention to sort of three bet get in the 35-40 big blinds. But it's a tough spot with ace jack. I mean, once Volta comes over the top here, it's not going to be a snap call from Urbanovic, and he's actually going to be a fold. I feel like ace queen maybe he would have gone with, but this is again a situation where he doesn't think Volta's ever going to really be shoving worse since he's raising under the gun, and he certainly didn't want to flap the ace jack off in the small blind there. So a lot of things you can learn about sort of how people value hands in different spots. And a very disciplined fold there. Unfortunately, obviously, he was going to be in a flip, but that's being, you know, rather results-oriented.
Yeah, and waves on min-raising from the small blind, which is also slightly unusual. Yeah, that's another situation. This is a term that we're going to be using repeatedly. Mm-hmm. That was another situation where he was using ace-jack essentially as blockers, yeah? He blocked the strongest hand that a folder can have, i.e. aces and jacks. So he used it as a three bet that he could fold. But sometimes Walter will pull with hands that are dominated, hands that can jack.
We're going to see an all-in here, definitely from Wen Zhang. He's running out of chips, and his hand's a bit too strong. He probably doesn't expect Walter to fold him.
Let's see a seven. Yeah,
there we go. Away.
And a hold. Yeah, thank you.
Get him back in the game. Wen Zhang, back at it again.
I mean, he has a... pretty hard dead compared to the other guys, and so I'm really pleased to see that. And now he can come out and play. Now he's got a stat where he can't just be, you know, he's not in a situation where when he's three back, he's got to go.
No, I think it's important for the viewer to see. So what made that situation where, you know, Volter just snap called the ace jack, and whereas Urbanovic just snap called it? It's all about position. Even though we are only playing with six guys on the table, you know, when Volter opens in the first position there, also known as under the gun, when Urbanovic three bets, you know, many seats over, and then he goes all in, his hand strength is going to be a lot stronger than, say, when Wayne Zhang opens the button and then he re-raises from the small blind. It just creates how you value your hand is definitely going to change, and that's why we saw the snap call from Volter and the snap call from Urbanovic.
Yeah. And we've got another blind-to-blind situation between two of our strongest players, Igor and Dimitri. I think Igor will take a left side here on the river.
Yeah, I mean, he's checked down because to do exactly what he did there. He doesn't want to bet there and get called by, you know, some sort of like 9-8 offhand, and then he has no equity. He waits for the river, reps showdown value. Urbanovic wasn't having anything of it.
And Jack said to this, one of the most beautiful hands in poker.
Oh, hearts. Love me.
But Volter, you know, showing no signs of being a good player, it seems like he's very, very capable at this level.
Yeah, I mean, it's really what I expected. I mean, I don't really think there are any weak links in regards to capability across the whole league. Arguably a guy like Bill Perkins, because obviously he's not a professional. He's more of a business guy that you know, does it sort of as a recreation. But this is also a guy, you look at Bill Perkins, so much experience playing with the best players in the world. You know, getting a lot of coaching from a guy like Jeff Groves.
Is Jason Lavallee a pro?
Yes, Jason Lavallee is a pro. He's one of the biggest guys.
He's some kind of comedian.
Well, this one again.
Some sort of celebrity TV celebrity. He plays for a living. Is that what he does?
Jason Lavallee plays for a living.
Well, I swear.
Really?
Jason Lavallee?
Yeah.
Wow, okay.
Are you serious?
Did you
not know who he was?
No, I've never heard of him.
Are you serious?
No.
I can't. This is going to be a problem if we're broadcasting. I don't know if we're doing a bit.
King Hart against King Hart.
really, back to the action, Sammy.
Back to the action. Great British accent,
thanks, man. Yeah, I'm actually half British, but that explains it.
Oh, you're half.
Yeah, my dad's from England.
Well, not actually. I think maybe so.
Yeah. I can't believe you tweeted the other day I was stuck in Vancouver. I'm from Toronto, you know.
Oh,
and it was a great tweet too. Like, I was happy to.
Invite the Overs to come and hang out, and maybe I'll get to know you.
I don't know you that well. Like, we've been working together
we'll see at the end of that.
30 minutes.
I'll be like the blood brothers. Okay, so Volta with Dominant King, and this is going to be a situation where he's going to limp call.
Yeah,
indeed. And flop strongly. See how the Vinny can work some magic here. Seems like it's going to be hard to get flop calls for certain.
A lot of the blind on blind battles we're going to be seeing again, blind on blind for those not familiar, the small blind and big blind, the two seats to the left of the button. Obviously, not all of our viewers are going to be completely familiar, but we're going to be seeing a lot of limping in as opposed to raising. You know, obviously, you're always going to be playing out of position from the small blind, and that's what Bulger decided to do with a hand like King 10. He didn't want to raise and get re-raised in a spot like that by Katai, but he's very happy to, as he gets super unlucky on the river here, very happy to limp call. And,
well, this is going to be, we'll see whether Davide's,
yeah, that'd be better.
We can see whether Davide's live leads work here, because on a walk,
Vaughn's just going to check. No, just has to check here, right? Is he going to bet like 1,200?
He's
going to bet 1,200. No, obviously, David, he recognizes that he has some jacks and some sevens in his range there. And maybe some queens, so just going to take it with the lucky river. Now, do you expect an open shove here with the 20 big blinds? Just an open fold by Ivanovich, and that has to do with the fact that it turns his hand face up, shoving the 20 big blinds, and you know everyone's going to be able to play their hand so correctly, and then he doesn't want to go out in fifth place when he has such an edge, you know, keeping himself in there.
Yeah, and also that, you know, some people would say, okay, if you're not going to shove it, why not raise it? But a player as well, someone that plays as well as Igor in the big blind, you know, the best thing that's going to happen is going to get through and be defending against Igor. And pretty much any hand he played is going to have two over cards. It's going to be difficult hand to negotiate. So he's just made a pretty solid fold there under the gun, and I certainly don't blame him.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of these hands are going to play themselves. Volter opening the button with the king 8 off, Igor defending with the ace 4 high. You know, not a card that Volter's going to be barreling on a lot with the three, as we can see Igor probably would have called once again. So this should go check, and Igor is going to take it with the ace 4 high. So let's have a quick look at the chip counts here. Igor, you know, early on he lost some chips in the first few hands, but really came into his own, played that great hand against Dimitri to take the chip lead. David East has been winning a lot of small pots, just playing as many pots as he can. Urbanovic obviously getting a little unlucky with that flush drop. But Wei Zhang back in it with the big flip win. And
there are points sacrificed at every stage of this. So, you know, if you have an all-in confrontation when you're covered, you know, everyone else sort of can move up the ladder. So there is a lot of, you know, the thing I want to emphasize for the viewers back home, and again, I think Ivor's going to take a little stab on the river and probably get...
Well, he bets the turn here. Yeah, so again, it's sort of using the same strategy, but deciding that because he has that minimal equity. A really interesting bet here that's going to get snap called. I think he just makes that bet because in case Ivanovich has something like, you know, jack 8 off with a diamond, that he's not going to be able to call with the jack high.
Yeah, so just to go back to what I was saying,
yeah.
The way that this is structured, you know, these guys aren't playing out and out for the, you know, it's not just about winning.
Yeah.
While it would be exciting and prestigious to take down the first ever match in the Global Poker League, you know, it's about accumulating points for your team.
Absolutely. Just really interesting open here from Katai. And again, this is what we're talking about, how he's going to play hands in really abstract ways and kind of flex his
game.
Gets your ways in, yes. So this is kind of some of the moves that you're going to watch and them happening and just think, wow, you didn't expect that. And beautiful work by both of them there. Let's talk about the match tomorrow.
Yeah, I think you heads up. Randy Lee, Naminoka, who has a big online following, big Twitch following.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we're going to see one of the Moscow Wolverines in action, Sergei Lebedev, and that's going to be a heads-up format, one-on-one.
And I think that's probably something that might, I guess, you know, not knowing a great deal about Lebedev's sort of strengths and weaknesses, Naminoka probably has a lot of experience playing heads-up, would you reckon? I mean, I know he's more of a, I guess, sort of a Zoom-cast game player, but do you think that he has a lot of experience
the
playing
heads-up? The thing I'd say is it's no record for these guys, yeah?
Yeah?
I mean, there's not many places to hide on a six-match table. I mean, playing heads-up with a big following, you know, on the channel, let's just see whether Igor elects to travel off and he just gives it up. You know, very exposing, you know, heads-up, we're going to learn a lot about what Randy Lee and Sergei Lebedev are going to bring to the GPA.
So Zhang here is going to have the ace 10 offsuit on the, I believe, the button here. And this might be another spot where Volter is going to 3-bet. And I would imagine that Wayne would shove. But we have David Lee in the big line of King. This is a really interesting hand. You can see a lot of different things happening here.
Yeah. I think with 30 big blinds, I think Wayne is probably going to just play in position. Because of this circumstance, exactly, some of Walter's bluffs are going to be completely dominated by ace-10, but when he shoves all in, he's only going to
right,
pull the ball hands that completely crush him. So we'll see. I mean, that would be my strategy. But
yeah, I mean, there's an argument to do any of the three things here, you know, to shove, forward, or flat. I mean,
that's pretty tough.
Yeah, I mean, it's also sort of a game flow thing. When we talk about game flow, I mean, the last time that he opened the button, Jason Lavallee talking about it, actually.
The comedian?
Comedian, yeah.
Amazing. So tell us about game flow then.
Well, and just in that spot, I feel like Wayne decided that Volta wasn't going to be light, and that's just from the different spots that they played in late position. You know, Volta's threw that him a lot of times, and that's sort of the thing, is that, like, is he really just coming after me here with, like, King 6 suited, like, he's just taking the spot every time against me?
Yeah.
And Wayne said, you know what, this spot isn't enough an edge. I'm out of here.
Yeah, and again, coming up in the corner of the screen, you can see, follow the conversation on Twitter, follow us at GPO. You can, if you demand the immediate sacking of me and Griffin Baker.
Yeah, let us know, please. I mean,
Hashtag sack Griffin and Spears. But yeah, you can complain and moan about us to the GPO directly, or tell us how much you love us. Tell us how to improve.
I mean, you know, we're obviously open to any and all kind of.
And tell us how much you love the video guitar. Do you love it as much as us?
Yeah, probably not.
And this is, again, sort of found that someone like myself, I might be tempted to fold here and cut off, but the video guitar is fine, and yeah, he's in the mix.
He's always in the mix.
And this isn't going to get a
point. In the mix.
This isn't going to get a point, is it?
No, I don't think so.
What do you think?
There's a couple ways to play this hand. I mean, obviously there's an argument to flat. There's no argument to fold.
Yeah,
he's going to shove it in there and a quick fold from Davidy.
And do you think that there's any chance, I mean, shoving that too far, do you think that's part of the adjustment to Davidy? I mean, if it was just a weaker player, perhaps you could take a lower variance option.
And just call or, you know, I mean, well, on that side, you don't ever really want to be folded. Four best holding a hand like ace queen, so right. I definitely think that it's one of those situations where he doesn't really want to play out of position against David. Yeah. He thinks that his hand is good a lot of. And the other thing too about a guy like David is that he wants to play out of hand, and he wants the reason. Like, I mean, he probably had half a mind looking at that 3-9 stupid. Like, I wish I was on like the button.
He loves the game.
He loves to play poker. Like, just an excellent selection.
Like when he was describing at the beach. He probably had a pack of cards with him as well. Davidy was just like putting out some blocks, you know, like ripping some chips.
Yeah, and I think Volta is probably aware of that. I mean, this is something that, you know, these guys have been looking forward to for a while. They knew what the matchup was, and he's probably thought, you know, Davidy's going to be on my left. He's going to want to play a lot of hands, so I need to fight back.
I agree, and it's also an area where he can check his teammates, consult with Max Pescatori, Mus McKenna, the great players who are part of his team, and say, hey, what strategy should I be adopting against these players? Obviously, the lineups have been out for a couple of days, and he knew he was going to be playing against Davidy, and he can make the appropriate adjustments.
Ooh. Where did that card come from? Who built this software?
I think it'll still probably be a check fold from Volta.
Yeah, I mean, Igor's going to be checking back a lot of hands that are showing value here. I would almost expect a snap fold from Volta. You know, he has some jacks. Obviously, he has some three deuces, apparently. Pretty unlikely that there was. I think that he might, just because he's not going to think that Volta, you know, might not come after him again. I think we're going to see the limp call strategy again here from Volta. So this is going to be a really fun hand to watch, because I think Volta would think that, you know, maybe Katai would just let him have one. But again, he don't give a damn.
Yeah. Well, Davidy's actually got it this time.
No. That's a mistake.
Oh, dear, Volta. Yeah. No, it's not an ace for Volta, though. I mean, yeah. What's Davidy, but...
How about a deuce for a little
shit? And when it goes,
and you know, when I say mistake, it's cool. I don't mean it. You know what I mean? It's definitely a high variance play. It's just something where he's just like, I don't want it. It's like we talked about. It's a game flow thing. It's just like, is he really gonna have a hand to call here? Yeah. And even when he does, I'm gonna be 30% against almost pretty much any hand.
I have done
plenty of limp shoves with the ace three for amount of blinds that I'm not comfortable admitting on air. So I wouldn't go as far as to call it a cooler. It's an ambitious sort of like go for the win play.
Yeah, and now Volta is in bad cooking position, right? I mean, yeah. This is
I mean, we're at 6-12 blinds here.
Yeah.
We're not kidding around.
Yeah.
This is the global poker.
And yeah, he's in no trouble now. And it also is going to mean that perhaps Dimitri's going to have to play title because he doesn't really want to bust before Walter because of the points scale. I mean, there's all sorts of things that are going to come into play. And this is a new format where the strategies aren't clear.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we're going to see, you know, a lot of tendencies start to be developed and then changed over the course of these 8 weeks. And that's the thing that's so great is that we're going to be here with you guys, you know, every day, Tuesday through Thursday, doing this for, you know, 6+ hours. And it's just going to have ebbs and flows. And it's its own sort of organism. It's going to be really organic how it ends up shaping up.
And you think you're going to call him? I'm putting on the spot.
Don't think
so. High school.
Yeah.
And he's in bad shape. He will need a 6, otherwise it's going to be a double up.
It's so close with the A6. Obviously, I feel more comfortable having, you know, I mean, the problem is that Dimitri is shoving such a wide Broadway range.
And now, actually, it's
happening so fast.
And it's the bidding that now has the chip lead. Things changing really, really rapidly.
We already have the chip lead.
I already have the chip lead. Okay.
Only start with 25.
Oh, yeah.
Turn to one elimination. He was the leader.
Okay, well, Igor back in the
I really love King Nine of Diamonds.
Dimitri does! Yeah, there we go. There we go. Coming in for a raise. And Walter really.
And I wonder if David's going to continue on the hand.
Yeah, Davide is going to call it for sure. Can someone check Davide's. Someone's living there.
Do we have a webcam set up for Davide to try? Everything he's done to this point.
And this is a little bit of a loose end for mine.
I'll go for a wings then, don't give a diagram. He's going for it. I love it. I mean, like, he's got to battle with these guys. He's got to pick his spot.
Sure, but Davide can put a lot. I mean, Davide can put a lot of pressure on him when Walter's down to 4 big bombs.
Yeah,
if Wayne's making correct strategic adjustments.
Yeah,
and Davide, entirely, he don't miss a trick.
I love the size of you too, because it just telegraphs. It's just like, listen, I'm putting you all in basically, and then when Wayne's hand actually starts. That he's going to snap hold. I mean, he's obviously going to adjust and do different things and keep people guessing. And now he's got 60,000.
It is speculated whether Davide could compete at this level. Do they?
I was just trying to figure things out.
I think it's Eric to me.
Definitely.
He said, I don't know whether Davide Kitar can compete. Definitely wasn't me.
No.
We've got Nolan.
No, I mean, they can see it.
Okay.
It's played itself. He's got the King 9, and he's been eliminated. The Dowd, Walter going down with the King.
Yeah, I mean, Walter played very well. Perhaps one misstep, arguably.
But he's going to learn from it, for sure.
He does put a point on the board for the Roman horse. And, you know, it's made history. He's won the first point.
The first
for the Roman horse.
Absolutely. Not even for anyone. He's point one.
Oh, yeah.
He's one point, man.
Well played, Walter. Walter. Chicality.
Walter. We'll call him point
one.
We won't call him that. We'll take it from the
can we just say, the Davide Kitar, he's got the favourite in this 400 format.
Absolutely.
Even, you know, as great as the other guys are, when you've got this kind of chip position, and also, he can now put pressure on Dimitri and Igor, because it's now Wayne Zhang who's the chip.
Exactly, yeah. And I just got to say, I mean, you know, about 40 minutes ago, I didn't even know how long the blind levels were, and you exposed me to everyone. But now that I see the way that it's... you know, playing out. I'm just saying. I'm liking the pace of these matches. I think it's exactly what we like to see, and the right balance. And this is something that you know, it's not as simple as just scraping together a few opinions here and there. This is something that you know, the people of the GPL really you know ask the players. What do you guys think is the best? What do you guys want? You know, guys like Igor Kurganov, very involved. This is going to be, wow, a lot of snap. Did you just open check that?
Yeah.
Okay, that would have told me. I was going to say it might have been an interesting hand if it opened. Oh, watch out.
Right? Yeah, but he's going to just get pulled in here, I think. And he can't call, unfortunately.
I know, can we just get a run out anyway? Queen 7, it's just like... Queen 7 suit is just like an AK and
well,
like
I mean,
M4.
I don't think this guy's going to happy when down games come out of this. Because you're not taking over a pressure on that. Because you don't want to be the guy.
And just knowing that he would just slam his desk and be super pissed about it. Like, I would get, like, you know, like a bit of a cheap thrill from knowing how much it bothers. Because I mean, he wants to play and you just get it's instantly cooler.
And this is going to be an all in the call as well.
Yes. Time to flip.
I gotta say, it's a classic race.
And I feel like Davide's gonna win this thing as well.
I disagree.
No, here it comes.
Here's Johnny. Oh!
I told you. Davide's not messing around, man.
Is that YouTube, like, ready, though? Like, the Here's Johnny thing? Like, they think we've seen it in the, like, we're in the future.
Yeah, this is live. We're as live as anyone.
That was completely...
I think, by the way, it's been a while. Call the team, they can tell us live. I think the viewers at home know that this is a...
Yeah. No, absolutely, yeah. Have we got a mega roll in here, dude? No, sorry.
Back to the action. Are we supposed to look at the camera? We're both admiring the camera, and we've actually got to look at the action.
Do you not know what we're supposed to do? now the match is over. Now it's they've established. Okay, now we're back.
So we've got a feedback from the guitar.
This is going to go through every damn time. Yeah. Unfortunate, everything's going Katai's way here.
Yeah, he's in a hugely commanding position. And actually, again, just to refer people back to the structure, what this is going to mean is that neither Igor, like there's a sort of battle between Igor and Dimitri to outlast each other.
Which is a 2-point swing.
There's a big points jump here. You know, if you go up there, you get
look at that. See, that's a great move there by Obama. He just limp shoved the 7-5-2. He's just like, hey, I know what you're doing. You're taking the no equity rather than.
I mean, maybe Dimitri's not going to abide by my.
Anyone's rules.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Probably going to use a raising strategy here.
And we're going to see a show from Igor here. And it's Snippet from the Frenchman.
Yeah, that's Steve's word for it. Igor taking his time to think it through. Igor was close.
Yeah, definitely an argument to play it that way.
I honestly think this is an adjustment because of that 2-point jump.
Yeah, you're right.
You know, if he has an all-in confrontation with Davide, one of the people that benefits most from that is the Navy. You know, every time your opponent's all in and you are just free rolling throughout that ladder.
You know, and it's interesting too, is that like it's easy to be an expert when you see the whole cards, and that's something that's always bothered me about whole card poker is that it's easy for our job to be like, oh, this is what's going
to
happen.
What you want, we can ask them to not show us the whole card the next time.
Oh, I already know what they have in.
and this is where Igor's background in this superhero game is obviously huge pages and equity decisions.
We're going to see an all-in here, though. Probably a limp. I would imagine just a raise, shove, call here, or do you think that he's just going to shove the 20 big blunt, 23 effective, 22 effective to make sure the difference is he's probably going to call. Here we go.
Can Davide Katai win another foot, or will Dimitri get that? He's ace or a nine, and we have lost Dimitri, and we have heads up with two of the legends of poker to win the first ever GPL match. Davide Katai,
look at the way he's
holding it. I mean, great start for the GPL, having these two legends battling it out to take the 7 points.
Yeah, really smooth sailing for Davide. Obviously, he won a few huge flips, but he really showed his flair and how comfortable he feels in this
match. He showed he's a massive luck box.
Yeah.
He showed, do not flip against this man, you can't beat him.
And this is going to end up being an all-in here, probably a double-up for Igor Kurganov.
Yeah, do you think he's going to check raise here?
I think he's going to check raise to about 4,200, and then Igor's going to put the rest in, and then David Katai is going to backwards raise.
There we go. No need to watch the rest of the sample out.
No, it's not. Just turn it off. we got a click back.
Oh, dear, Davide. You think Davide's feeling this time?
Yeah.
Well, he was loving it in Eagle Shed, and now
he's peeking, yeah.
No, he's not! Davide Katai is Davide Katai is some kind of witch doctor. Oh, my God. He's unbelievable.
I'm so
sick. I don't care.
Oh, my God.
He's a sport.
I'm done.
I'm not playing with him.
I'm putting my. Here, can we get on camera here? I can't do this.
Has actually got to come up here. The guy says the afternoon at the beach. He's relaxed. He's chilled. He's on the beach with Mrs. Katai, having a great time. And he just comes and makes faults like that. I mean, he's actually embarrassed Igor a little bit there. He has pulled Igor's pants down a little bit.
And now look at his 2x shove the river here. Let's not compare it.
I can't even follow. We're breathless. If you understand what Davinci is, you need to make terrific GPL.
Yeah.
I get it,
but I just could never do it.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? That's the problem. I get it.
And it's an all in.
And seven hearts for the
stream. You're going to need some help. Six or an eight, otherwise, we're going to have our first winner. Davinci Kataya.
It's over! Davinci Kataya is the winner.
Seven points. Lead to the top.
I'm still having trouble with that hand, but he's obviously amazing.
Congratulations to Davinci Kataya. Fantastic performance.
Yeah, Igor squeaking in the 5 points, second place there for the London Royals. That was a good time. Yeah, I learned a lot.
I kind of just wanted to watch.
You don't even need to do this. Can we just watch the matches and discuss? That was like.
That was kind of cool.
Run it once. You don't need any of those guys anymore.
Yeah, that was amazing. Davinci Kataya single handedly fortified poker.
Yeah.
You know, after an afternoon, I think.
Never for a superstar.
What an amazing guy. But to be fair, all the guys put themselves well. And I think we should say fair play to them, because, you know, we're nervous about commentating. I mean, how nervous was they to step up and say to the managers, yeah, I'm willing to go in the first game. I'm willing to step up and play under all that screening.
I feel like there's more pressure for us to go. I know exactly what you mean. I mean, to take the reins there and Wayne Zhang was obviously, you know, I would never go as far as to say he was outmatched. I mean, a lot of the situations, you know, nobody else would have played them differently. But he showed a little flair in some certain pots, you know. He made a bit of a tight pull with the ace-10 that you weren't crazy about. But the 5-4 off, recognizing how wide, you know, he's probably someone that him and his team did a lot of research beforehand, being like, okay, Davinci Kataya is going to do a lot of different things here.
Everyone came to play. Yeah.
Exactly, absolutely.
Yeah, I agree.
But only one man came to win.
Yeah. Yet again, what an amazing guy. So, do we go for Laura in the studio now?
They should signal to us to let us know.
Post analysis.
We're still doing the post mortem. Yeah, let's talk more about
that. Okay, well, Igor quickly in touch with you. As everyone expected. It was interesting that, you know, in terms of reputation, Davinci, Igor, and Dimitri, that was our 1-2-3.
Yeah, I mean, Valter, you know, came out the gate swinging, obviously, winning the first three pots of the GPL. So that is, I mean, he did make history. Daniel Cates, you know, obviously making history himself and not too thrilled with the title of the first ever.
Well, he cost himself a laptop as well.
Yeah, at least one of them. But he can afford more, I'm sure.
Yeah,
a lot of exciting things. But again, like the star of the match, obviously, Davinci Kataya. Just so much fun to watch. I kind of just want him to just play the next. He is in the next round. I'm staying then.
So, you know, just to recap, we're going to see these guys in action again with two substitutes coming in, and then we've got an even more exciting lineup later in the day. We're going to see the first game from the Americas group.
Yeah, let's talk about the substitutions really quickly. We have, you know, Igor obviously doing great work for the London Royals, squeaking out those 5 points, and subbing in is
one
and boss of online tournament poker. If anyone isn't familiar, Christopher Moorman, I mean, mostly goes by Chris, $13 million in online earnings. You're someone who obviously, you know, was in his camp for a while, definitely popped hands with him, you know, gone for drinks with him. Tell me a bit about Chris, just as a guy, as a player.
Well, Chris, when you meet him, is the most affable, guy you could ever hope to meet. But when it comes to competing in poker, he cares so much about the game. He loves the game. I mean, you can't play online enough to rack up $14 million in online results unless you're absolutely passionate about poker.
Yeah.
He cares very much about, you know, he's been ranked number one in the world several times. He has his accolades, the Triple Crowns, winning three tournaments in a week, which he's done more times than anyone else. Obviously, the LAPC title has an impressive resume. He cares about his standing in the poker world, because every time he goes out and plays online poker, he stretches that record even further and he's making history. So I really think that the GPL format, battling for points, battling for teammates,
it's going to bring out the best.
Yeah, it's going to really suit Chris, and he's going to be someone that you can certainly rely on to bring his A game, you know, to this second match.
So let's talk about the other substitution. Players that are not that known to, you know, people outside of the APPT circle. We had Wayne Zhang in there, fought his best there to get the fourth place finish, pardon me. We had Raven Khan all the way from Mortal Kombat.
So Raven Khan, yeah, of course. I mean, he's got nearly $1 million in tournament earnings. Obviously, again, if you're a Shark Cage winner.
Start with the Shark Cage.
I might not seem that much to you, Griffin, but for those guys at home and for myself, you know, that's a very impressive.
No, this is obviously a guy that's been doing really, really well. And that's what justifies the 13th overall pick last year.
And also, the other thing to say about the way the poker economy works is, you know, this guy might be sat in the Cal Cash games playing for huge amounts of money, which are going completely untracked. Obviously, we know about those tournament players, tournament heroes like, you know, ourselves and our friends, who, you know, when they win a large amount of money, there's a picture with a trophy that they put up on Facebook. But, you know, for some of these guys playing in high-stakes cash games, you know, that kind of the money.
I've never seen the picture of you with the trophy, isn't it?
Grand final, but you know, he could be playing huge cash games, and you know, Selena Lin, she put together this team, and I'm really excited to see them come.
Yeah, and I think the one thing that we learned really quickly is, you know, 1-6 max match really shows us what to expect from a lot of these players. Davide right away showed the entire world how good he is and can be. You know, Igor playing extremely well, Urbanovic playing, you know, near pitch perfect, and Wayne Zhang finding those little spots where he can, you know, exploit. And Volta showing up there early on, too.
The crowd was extremely strong. And I think that, to be honest, like, one of the difficult things for Chris, if he comes in and Igor's already got second, I mean, that's a lot of pressure. Now, when you're subbing Igor out and you're coming in, Chris is going to try and emulate Igor and try and go one better and get that first place finish.
And now let's talk a little bit about how that first match is going to affect these players. Again, like, 4 of the 6 are still the same.
Well, obviously, going to have to buy a second laptop.
Obviously, you know, Mormon and Raiden were watching, you know, the first match, so they know exactly, you know, what happened. So how is that going to affect the play styles? Are we going to see a lot of different things from different players?
Of course, yeah. So one of the interesting things is, I mean, people know Davide's reputation anyway, but they've seen him put 8-7 off on the button. They've seen him maybe 5-4 offsuit on the cutoff. I mean, that's going to play into the next round. Like, maybe people are going to come off to him a little bit lighter. People are going to be defending their big blinds wider, check raising them more, putting pressure on him. Because the thing is, you know, you and I don't know, but for the viewers at home, like, people are playing those wider ranges. If they have weak holdings, it's going to make it more profitable to attack them with re-raises before the flop. It's going to make them make it more profitable to attack them after the flop. So maybe Davide isn't going to be able to get away with playing as many hands as he did there, but if Davide could try, you know, he's already shown what he can do. You know, maybe it won't slow him down.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where it's not necessarily going to affect how many hands he plays, but it's probably going to affect how he plays them. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to see a lot of things that are going to surprise some people. He's going to analyze hands that he talked about a lot differently from your average Joe like us. I mean, he makes me and like we feel very emasculated. Like, it's just like he was incredible and really just established himself as a force here.
Yeah,
early
I think
tomorrow.
That's one of the things, because obviously there's been a big build up to the GPL League launching. And particularly with the draft, obviously, incredible amount of buzz created. And I think one of the great things is, you know, we knew we had an awesome lineup, but so many interesting hands there. I mean, the guys behind the scenes, you know, were supposed to pick up, we wanted like one or two hands as high as
yeah.
There's a whole raft of hands. You know, such an interesting hand between Igor and Dimitri after he had that big double up, when he broke the three bet with ace-9, suited, then he floated the flop and turned that flush draw. And, you know, Igor obviously had that, you know, like rounders or something, the patients would check the turn and let Dimitri shove with a bluff on the turn. So, you know, really, really
high-level stuff. Yeah,
exactly.
And can we talk about the fact that, I mean, Fabrizio's off camera right now, not looking at all surprised at the dominance that he's... he's just like, yeah, he won, obviously. So, obviously, a great showing from Pitai. Should we see what our friends are doing?
Maybe they're going to get Fabrizio in the lounge and make a check to
him. Laura?
That indeed is exactly what we're going to do for Bruce Julian, manager of the Paris Aviators. Congratulations! Your gang have won the first
That's
ever
game. That's what I was doing. I was watching the game, so I'm so happy. I'm so happy.
What was the decision? Why go with Davide as the player to play these first two matches?
Like I said before, I think he's one of the most accomplished players in the Mexican team, and he's very confident at the moment. He's playing at the top of his game, and I had no problem making him face all those great players. You know, I thought if he could fight, and he fought more than expected by winning this thing. It's unbelievable. I'm so happy that Paris Aviator won the first game.
Exactly. It's something to say, isn't it? What did you think to some of the other moves, some of the other play going on in that game?
It was interesting. I mean, here with you in the studio, I couldn't really focus on what was played, and I think we'll have some discussion later on with the team, so I'm sorry I can't give too much input because I didn't have time to do being here and having nothing involved with
it. Too much excitement in the studio, isn't it, for our first
episode? I'm the only player. I hope more players come in the studio.
Davide's right back in it. He's got another match in just a few minutes, so hopefully another win by the Indians.
That would be great. We have a big bet, you know. The water is at 15 degrees Celsius, and I said, if you come first and second, I go in the water.
He's in great position right now.
He's in great position. I'm still rolling, actually, because he had to score less than 4 points, so I think that's even more.
Shark or a fish?
He's still rolling. That's okay. I'll go in the water.
Swimming with the sharks or with the fish?
I'll be happy. No, I'll just go in shallow water, not deep water.
Is the fact that the first match you beat London heads up, doesn't that make you even more satisfied about getting those kind of points?
Yeah, it's great. It's one of the most.
It's a good game. It's in London. It's a rivalry, right?
Yeah. But I used to live in London. I love London. I just think there's one of the most competitive teams in the world. That's for sure. So I'm happy with that. Big one, yeah.
The Didi gets physical warning next. Another big player right in there. Does a strategy, does a strategy change by the players they're playing, or is it too new still that they're still...
Yeah, he knows all the players, and I think he knows what to do. We spoke a little strategy about it, of course, and he's called that now, he's going to adapt, I'm pretty sure, confident.
And also tomorrow, it's an exciting heads-up match. We've got Elkie versus Jungle Man Dan. Didn't fare so well today, did he?
Zero points for Jungle Man, so he's going to have to get those back tomorrow.
Yeah.
What about the big matchup, Elkie and Jungle? What are your thoughts on that?
I think it's going to be a difficult match. Elkie was a little tight this weekend. He had a little flu, so I was concerned. I even thought about changing and swapping at one point. And I said, no, I'll be okay for tomorrow. I'll be able to play my best. So I trust Elkie a lot.
Well, let's hope the rest of the season goes as well as it has done so far.
Number one.
Let's see if you can hold on to it.
Let's stop it.
Not quite yet. We've not had enough yet. Thank you so much, manager of the Paris Aviators for Beast Studio. We're going to take a look at some of the tweets we've had in whilst the game was in.